Theater starring Jessica Dragonette, tonight's romance, The Student Prince, a story of an impetuous prince whose love for a waitress threatened his throne and the woman he loved. The Palmolive Beauty Box Theater is brought to you every Wednesday night by the makers of Palmolive soap. The Student Prince, starring Jessica Dragonette.
Saying good evening to my friends of the Palmolive Beauty Box Theater. With Al Goodman's orchestra, I have just sung a little bit of one of the lovely songs of tonight's story, Deep in My Heart. I can't tell you how sorry I am that I was unable to sing for you these past 2 weeks, but I shall never forget the kind messages of deep concern which you sent me. And I want to thank Lanny Ross for stepping in at the last minute and the makers of Maxwell House Coffee, who so generously gave him permission to appear. But tonight, I'm thrilled to sing the part of the wise little waitress Kathy in The Student Prince. It's a most interesting story of a wild but likable young prince who fell in love and jeopardized his throne. That excellent young tenor, William Hayne, is Prince Karl, and in his scarlet uniform, he looks very handsome indeed. Now, Jean Paul King, to tell you the situation as the story begins. If you will, Jean.
With pleasure, Miss Dragonette. In the palace of Carlsberg, old King Johann, grandfather of Prince Karl, has decided it's high time to teach his wild living and pleasure-loving grandson that he has a real responsibility to face, and that right now is the time to do some serious thinking about the future.
Karl, I've been hearing wild stories about your behavior, how you insist on going about with the most ordinary kind of young men, and you drink too much, and that, to put it very plainly, you have most unfortunate ideas about your choice of women companions.
I suppose things do sound pretty bad by the time they reach your ears, Grandfather. But I get so fed up sitting around the palace doing nothing. I want to live and laugh and enjoy myself.
But my boy, consider your royal position.
Time enough of that later, sir. Meanwhile, I'm finding out a great deal about the people I shall someday have to govern. And to tell the truth, Grandfather, I like them very much.
Yes, too much for your own good. I've made all arrangements for you to enter the University of Heidelberg. It is my hope that the general atmosphere will inspire you to serious thought of the responsibilities that will someday be yours as King of Carlsberg.
I hope it will be many years before that day comes, Your Majesty. As for going to Heidelberg, the idea of drinking beer with a lot of students sounds as though it might be a lot of fun.
Our coffee. Bring us beer, the very best beer in all Heidelberg.
We all want beer. Beer from so pretty a waitress tastes more like champagne.
You don't deserve one little glass, Carl.
Why, Carly, how could you say such a thing?
Well, it was bad enough for you to get the poor old coachman drunk, but when you harnessed him to his own carriage, I think you went too far.
I couldn't get his fat old horse into the carriage. I felt very badly about that.
And just for that, you get no beer from me.
I'm quite right, too. What's more, that goes for the rest of you. Let someone else carry out your orders. I'm carrying out Carthy. Up with you!
Oh, put me down, Carl. Do you hear? You behave worse than any student that ever came here to Heidelberg.
I bet I have more fun.
Oh, put me down.
It's just what I meant to do. There. Oh. Now then, Carthy, I want one of your very best kisses.
Oh, no. But suppose... Carl. Who'd ever dream that you'll be king of Carlsberg someday?
I hate to think of it.
In the 6 months you've been in Heidelberg, you've thought of nothing but having a good time. You know, you're a headstrong, unbelievably bad boy, and you'll probably be a very bad king. That is, if actions prove anything.
Some do, some don't. When I put my arms around you and kiss you, that means a lot.
Oh, you simply won't realize how serious I am. And how much you're hurting yourself by drinking beer all day and saying, I'm sure I don't know, to the professors all next day.
Oh, come on, Carthy. You really don't look your prettiest when you're scowling. Listen to what this wonderful night is saying to us. Can't you hear the music in our hearts?
Oh, I'm afraid I do. But we mustn't listen. This night is dangerous, Carl, dearest.
Dangerous? No. You're safe in my arms, Carthy, where you belong. Your gentle eyes are telling mine how well they know the meaning of our love. We're together. We belong to each other. And look, Carthy.
Overhead, the moon is beaming. White as blossoms on the bough. Nothing is heard but the song of a bird, filling all the air.
Than all the thrones in the whole world.
Oh, you may think so now, Carl. But when the time comes, you'll take your place on the throne of Carlsberg. You will, because you must.
Who knows about the future? All I know is that you're in my arms, and that I want to keep you here, that the night is dark and friendly, that...
Overhead, the moon is
Carthy, darling, I've made up my mind.
To do what you should?
To leave Heidelberg at once and take you with me.
But where? What are you going to do?
Not another word. Pack your things and we'll get the first train to Paris.
We'll be married, settle down, and live happily ever after.
Oh, but Carl, I can't let you give up everything life has meant you to be just because you think you love me.
Think I love you? I know I love you, Kathy. Just as I know the Paris train will go without us unless we...
Who's that?
Alphonse!
What? It's Dr. Engel from Carlsberg.
Alphonse, your highness. I have a message for you from the people of Carlsberg.
What is it, Dr. Engel? Why did you come here? Why all this formality?
Your grandfather, King Johann Frederick of Carlsberg, passed away this afternoon.
Oh, Carl.
The people of Carlsberg await your immediate return. The king is dead.
Long live the king.
It is to you, Carl Franz, that our people now look for guidance and leadership. The throne is waiting for you, Your Majesty.
But, Doctor, I... Carthy, I don't want the throne. I want...
You must forget your own wants, Carl Franz. I've always tried my best to teach you. Your life is not your own. You are now king of Carlsberg.
But every king's a man. If I've got to give up Carthy, then I refuse the throne.
Refuse it? But, Carl...
Wait, Dr. Engel. Listen to me, Carl Franz. You're a spoiled, thoughtless, utterly selfish boy. You have no right to refuse the throne. Your people need you.
Need me? What for? What good would I be, sitting on the throne in an ermine straitjacket?
But you wouldn't be that kind of a king. You love your people too much. You've drunk beer at their tables, made friends of innkeepers, beggars, barmaids, and blacksmiths. They all love you. For you to turn your back on them now would be to betray your birthright and the people's faith in you.
I've never given that much thought to it, Carthy. I only knew we were in love.
Yes, Carl, we are. But the crown is yours, and you must take it. And leave me here in Heidelberg, where I belong. Just remember me sometimes as a girl you used to know and love. And I'll always carry your image and the memory of you deep in my heart forever. This is goodbye, Carl. And yet, deep in my heart, dear, I have a dream of you. Fashioned of starlight, perfume of roses and dew.
Youth, life, music, and love are all against giving you up.
Birth, breeding, training, and tradition say you must, Carl. Be a man and accept your fate. I'll never forget you. And, Carl, you can always know that deep in my heart, dear, I have a dream.
Our powers mustn't sever, Carthy.
Oh, you have no right to say that, Carl. You were born to be king.
Come, Your Majesty. The girl is right. This must be goodbye.
Perhaps it must. But
deep in my heart,
in just a moment, we'll see what the lovely Kathy's renunciation of her royal lover will mean to herself, to Carl, and to the people of Carlsberg. Right now, may we let you hear an experience of a young lady at 104 West 174th Street, Bronx, New York. A girl whom I have no doubt is as lovely as our own Kathy, Miss Elsie Strouch.
I'm 22 years old. When I was in high school, I was very popular. But a year ago, I found I wasn't being invited out as I used to be. What was the matter? Well, one day I opened the American Weekly, and there, staring me in the face, was a Palmolive advertisement that pointed out no girl could expect to be popular if her complexion was beginning to show signs of dry, lifeless, middle-aged skin. Well, my skin was beginning to show signs of dullness and dryness. There were tiny lines in my skin. I read the entire ad. Read that Dr. Defoe had selected Palmolive as the only soap he considered gentle and safe enough to protect the skins of the little Dion quintuplets. So I started using Palmolive. And today, well, I don't see how I could have any more fun. On the go all the time.
Ladies, middle-aged skin begins with a slight dryness and dullness, almost invisible lines. It's very common indeed, even among girls in their 20s. But Palmolive soap will help you to have a young skin again, smooth and alluring. For Palmolive soap is made with that finest of all beauty ingredients, olive oil. Palmolive's lather is utterly different from that of any other soap, for it does more than merely cleanse gently and thoroughly. It also soothes and protects the skin, overcomes dry, lifeless, middle-aged skin, helping to make your complexion smoother and more alluring day by day. Are you worried over the first signs of dry, lifeless, middle-aged skin? Then don't you want to follow the example of millions of lovely women the world over and use Palmolive soap to have a lovelier, more alluring, really schoolgirl complexion? And now for the rest of our musical love story, The Student Prince. Jessica Dragonette's production tonight here in the Palmolive Beauty Box Theater. It's coronation day at Carlsberg.
Hurry, Hilda. Well, there'll be no room left in the palace courtyard.
But they say there'll be no coronation.
It's his duty to become king.
That's all you know about love.
Oh, you women.
It's a good thing we don't have a coronation every day, Lieutenant.
From what I hear, there won't be a coronation today either. They say the cabinet won't permit it. Hey, now, don't crawl back. Get back.
He ought to be exiled, that's what.
You're crazy. We ought to build monuments to him for having the courage to say what he thinks.
Look, there's a carriage driving up to that private entrance to the palace.
Say, look who's getting out. It's that waitress they say he's in love with. I know her from a picture.
Come, get back there. I said, let the lady pass.
Carthy, thank heaven you've come at last.
I got here as soon as I could, Dr. Engel. Your message was so mysterious. It just said, Karl Franz needs you, Carthy, but his people need you even more. Please come at once.
I suppose you've heard of his recent threats to refuse the crown.
Yes, Doctor. I'm sorry. But what can I do?
His ministers are powerless. Only you can make him see exactly where his duty lies.
But how can I, Doctor, when I love him?
You must, Carthy, because you love him. Not for me, not even for Carlsberg, but for his own sake.
For his own sake.
Exactly.
I see. Well, Doctor, I may be a very poor actress, but I'll try.
God bless you, my child. Come, I'll take you to him now.
Before I change my mind, you mean, Doctor? Where is he?
We'll find him in the main hall. Up these stairs, my dear. Some of your old friends are with him.
My old friends? Who?
Carl's classmates from Heidelberg.
The students, Doctor.
Yes. I asked them to come, hoping they might help persuade him to do his duty. Here we are. Wait till they finish singing. I'll open the door a little bit so that you can hear them better.
A toast to Karl Franz, the youth we knew as one of us, and to the man he has since become, King Karl Franz of Carlsberg. Yes.
To King Karl Franz.
Wait! Stop it! You drink to a life of loneliness. What happiness will I have in being king?
It's up to you now, Carthy. You are the only hope.
I'll do all I can, Doctor, but promises are not very much use.
Here he comes. Your Majesty, I have brought you a visitor.
What? What? Carthy, little Carthy. Oh, my darling, if you only knew how I'd hate to see you again.
I've often thought of you, Your Majesty.
Come, Carthy, let's go where we can be alone. Excuse me to the others, Dr. Engel.
I will. With pleasure, Your Majesty.
I have so much to say. Oh, sit here and let me look at you. Yes, you're even lovelier than I remembered.
Thank you, Your Majesty.
Tell me, how's old Heidelberg? Huh? Still the same?
Well, business at the inn isn't very good, but it's still the same. You've grown a little thinner, Your Majesty.
Darling, what's the matter? I'm Karl, the man who loves you, the man you love.
Oh, Your Majesty, do you remember how we used to say those silly things? Hans and I, Hans is my husband. We often laugh about it now.
Your husband?
Oh, yes.
I see. And do you laugh when you remember the May moon on the River Neckar? The promises we made, the way I held you to me, and knew why men had arms.
I had almost forgotten.
Oh, no, Kathy. Your eyes remember, and your lips, they remember mine. You'll never forget our love.
But, Carl, have you forgotten that you promised the last day I saw you? Does all this mean nothing to you now?
It means a great deal. I've gone mad, trying desperately to hold myself to my promise. But those days we spent together crowded in and thrust the kingdom of Carlsberg into another world. Do those days mean nothing to you, Carthy?
Oh, Carl, they're my precious dreams, too. How often I shut my eyes to feel again your strong arms holding me to you, to know the warm glow that swept over me when you first said, I love you. They were wonderful, precious days, Carl, that seemed to have happened so long ago now. Golden days in the sunshine of our happy youth. Golden days full of innocence and full of truth. In our hearts we remember them all else above.
Remember those golden days so well, Kathy. Yet you say you laugh at them, your husband and you. What's his name, did you say?
Wilhelm.
It was Hans the first time.
Oh, Carl.
I know, dearest. You thought you were helping me. You have, Kathy, but not in the way you meant to. You tried hard to convince me you no longer loved me. But I saw the real truth in your eyes.
I told Dr. Engel I was a very bad actress.
Thank heaven for that, Kathy. Now I know exactly what to do. My people are waiting word from me in the palace courtyard. Well, they shall have it. They shall have it, Kathy. Listen to what I'm going to tell them from the balcony. People of Carlsberg, I am not unaware of the rumors which have gone about concerning whether or not I would accept the crown. I might say the rumors are not without foundation. For generations, my ancestors have sat on the throne of Carlsberg, bound by tradition, unable to call their souls their own. That I will not do. If I were to be the kind of royal figurehead my ministers would make me, I could no longer enjoy the privilege of being one of you. I will not give up that privilege. On one condition only will I accept the crown of Carlsberg. It is that I be permitted to rule as I think best. And that means that I shall spend much of my time with you, my people. And my first act as king will be to choose one from among you. Choose her as my wife and your queen. If you approve my course, I will be most happy to hear it.
We approve, all right. I say long live the king!
Long live the king!
Well, little Carthy,
What will your husband, Hans, say to that?
Oh, Carl, my dearest. It frightens me to know that you love me that much.
Oh, my own dear one.
Believe me, I'll try my best to be worthy of you. My every thought and action from now on will prove how much you are a part of me. That deep in my heart's deep, I have a dream of you.
A sound of starlight, perfume of roses and you.
And so we leave Carl Franz smiling into the eyes of the girl who meant more to him than a throne. In just a moment, Miss Jessica Dragonette will tell you about next week's production here in the Palmolive Beauty Box Theater. But first, may I ask a favor of every woman listening? Ask yourself this question, won't you? Is my complexion as young-looking as I'd like it to be? Or do I see the first warning signs of dry, dull, lifeless, middle-aged skin? Now, I don't know what your answers will be to those questions, but I do wish to commend to you the gentle, safe beauty soap that the little Dion quintuplets use for the protection of their tender skin, and that millions of fastidious women the world over depend on to help them have a smoother, lovelier complexion. That's Palmolive soap, of course, the lovely, pure soap made with olive oil, the famous beauty soap that, used regularly, cleanses, protects, and soothes your skin and helps you to gain a complexion that's softer and more alluring. And now here's Miss Jessica Dragonette to tell you about next week in the Palmolive Beauty Box Theater.
Thank you, Jean. Well, it's quite a different setting for next week's story. Mexico, the Rio Grande River, and vivacious, tempestuous Rio Rita. Don't forget, I'm counting on your letters to help me choose these stories each week. Write to me in care of your own station. And now, as my good night to you from the Colgate Palmolive Peat Company, Al Goodman's orchestra and I will bring you one of the most famous songs from next week's story.
Student Prince was presented tonight by a special arrangement with the Tams Whitmark Music Library. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.